Okay, welcome to the Central Florida Computer Society Windows Special Interest Group, or SIG, or WinSIG, as I call it, for Sunday, March 13th, 2016. I am in Bradenton, Florida, while the meeting is being held in Castleberry, Florida, in the Orlando area, about 120 miles away. I do this the second Sunday of every month. It used to be live, and since I moved to out of the area, I continue the Windows Special Interest Group via the internet. And when we get a recording, I do post it on the WinSIG website, which I'm going to talk about in just a few minutes. I welcome everybody who's in the audience. We have a couple of people online. And if we get a good recording, we will have it also posted on YouTube. So it, let me go ahead and hide this and going to share my screen. And let's see, I need to close this, minimize this, full screen this. Okay, the first thing I want to talk to you about is the new Huey's Views and Reviews website. It was released about a week and a half ago. I redid it completely in WordPress. It is the home of the Windows SIG information, but it also is blogs and listings of websites that I've maintained since around 1995. As you can see, I have some recent blogs. I am blogging more now and posting them now that I have a website that I can do it easily. And so I invite you to make it a regular habit of checking Huey's Views and Reviews, where I do talk about interesting and up-to-date information about technology, software, hardware, and of course Windows. If you'll notice at the top, I have the Windows SIG and I have meeting notes going back to 2008. We have been running the Windows Special Interest Group since before that, but I only have the notes online since 2008. Now if you go to the meeting notes from 2016, you'll get a page like this. I'm going to make it larger so you can see it. And then when I click on, let's look at last month's first. These are last month's notes. And what I did is I also embedded a video of the meeting, and the complete slideshow is there. Now, today I'm not using a slideshow, so there won't be any kind of a slideshow. If I get a good recording, I'll add the recording to it. So if we go back to the Windows SIG 2016, we're going to go to this month's. And there's the notes, excuse me, that I've posted for this month. I'm not going to do it quite in the order that it's there because the first item is what I'm going to spend probably most of the time on. I may not get to anything below the second one, but I'm going to start with the second article, which is the shutdown or restart shortcut in Windows 10. How do you create one? And so what I have is an article here. Let's see if I can make that larger. And when you click on that link, it'll take you to this website, but you can create a desktop shortcut for shutdown, restart, log off on Windows 10 desktop. What I'm going to do is show you how to do the Windows 10 shutdown and create an icon on your desktop that's a one button. You double click it and your computer shuts down. To do that, what you need to do is highlight what's in yellow here. I'm going to do it. You should be able to see that. And when I do a Control C, or I can do a drop down and do a copy, but I'm going to do Control C to copy that. It's now copied. Now I don't need this article anymore, but so I'm going to minimize this because we've got my desktop, and I'm going to close this. I don't need this. And I'm going to take a blank spot on my desktop, and I'm going to go to New and shortcut. Hopefully you can see that on the screen. When I click that, I get this box. What term would you like to create a shortcut for? And you can browse to a location to create a shortcut, but I just copied something, so I am now going to do a Control V or paste and put that link in that box. Then I'm going to click Next to continue. And then I'm going to give it a name. I'm going to call it CFCS Shutdown, I believe is what I called it. I'm not going to complete this, but when I click Finish, what happens is I get this right here. And what I'm going to do now, as soon as you get that, I'm going to right mouse click it and go to Properties. You will see in the Properties box, I don't know if I can make that bigger or not. We'll try it, see if we can. No, that's as big as I can make it. Sorry about that. But you'll notice that what I highlighted and pasted is now in what is called the target. It starts in that automatically was made when I created the shortcut. I don't have a shortcut key, but I could actually make one if I wanted to. I'm going to run it in a normal window. What I want to do is change the icon. I'm going to click it. It's going to tell me that there are no icons there. And so I'm going to just say OK. And when I do that, it opens up the root icons. And I'm going to choose the on-off button. You can choose whatever you want, but that seems to be one that jumps out. And when I do that, I can then say apply it or just hit OK. When I do, it changes it. And now I have the CFCS shutdown. If I double-click that, it turns my computer off. So I'm not going to do it. But I did want to show you how to create a button, a one-button shutoff for Windows 10. And that's how you do it. Hopefully there are no questions about that. I see there's a comment. Let's see if David's not getting sound. I'm presuming, since I've not heard anything, everybody else should be. Dave, you might want to go out and come back in. So I am now going to go to this troubleshooting guide. How I found this guide was that apparently it's the author of this guide or somebody that works for the company s sent me an email and asked me to add this in the listing of my on the website. And when I looked at it, I said, well, this would make a good article to talk about. So let's do that. What you'll notice it in the troubleshooting guide, there's lots of information. There are several chapters, and that's what you see, the 1, 2, 3, 4. But you can also navigate with the drop-down. Chapter 1, Chapter 2. So Chapter 1 is installing, updating, and activating Windows 10. Chapter 2, input troubleshooting in Windows 10, devices and drivers, and Windows 10 personalization is Chapter 4. And I'm going to cover a couple of those. And then there's also ease of access, account security and privacy, Cortana, Microsoft Edge, network and web troubleshooting, email and communication. Let's see if I can make this bigger. I can. Good. Music and photos, application and the Windows Store, files and folders, online storage with OneDrive, repair and recovery, maintenance performance guide, and troubleshooting common problems in Windows 10. I'm just going to cover a couple of the items here, and I'm not going to really go through them step by step. I just want to show you what they are demonstrating in this website, and the fact that you've got a link now to it from the WinSig. You can go to it and look at it at your convenience and on your time. Okay, let's go look at the start button first. The desktop view in Windows 10 now features a start button in the lower left-hand corner. You can also change the start menu into a full-screen menu that looks like a start screen but offers you the taskbar in your desktop. So you can leave it to make it look like Windows 7, or you can make it look like Windows 8. Now, the start menu customization, and I've talked about this in a previous WinSig, but I'm going to talk a little bit about from this article. But the start button can be customized. And let's say you want to change or personalize some of the aspects. So you can pin anything that's in your all apps to the start menu. You can also pin them to the taskbar. And once you've pinned them to the start, you can then resize it, change it, make it bigger, move it around, and so on. So you can manage the tiles in any way you want, and then you can unpin it, unpin the ones you don't want, just by right mouse clicking over the box that you want to remove, and just tell it to unpin from the start. By customizing the left column and the right column, you can easily control how much you want to stick with the standard start menu and how much you want to tap into the tiled screen portion. So you can do quite a bit with this. You can turn on and off the live mode of some of the tiles. For instance, the news will keep changing the news. If that gets confusing or you don't want to show that, you can tell it by right mouse clicking and telling it to turn off the live feature for that. The next thing I want to talk about is the Action Center. Now, the Action Center is the, not sure if you can see it at the bottom of the screen, it's the white, it's the notification area. When I click on it, it looks like this. It shows some emails that I've received, some things in Outlook, I just cleared it, but it also gives me some things at the bottom that I can click on and control from within the Action Center as well. When you move outside the box and click, it goes away. Now, it is new in Windows 10. It's a unified place for all system notifications and quick access to various settings. It lives in that slide out that you saw that appears at the press of the icon in the taskbar. It's a nice addition to Windows, and it's highly customizable. The Action Center customization can be handled within your settings by going to Settings and System, and then Notification and Actions. And opening those under the Quick Actions heading, you'll notice four boxes, each representing one of the four actions that remain visible at all times. You click the boxes to get a new menu, and it lets you pick and choose which actions will get one of the coveted four slots. You can also, under the notification headings, you can turn those on and off of what you're going to get. You can show tips about Windows. You can show app notifications, show notifications on the lock screen, show alarms, reminders, and incoming VoIP calls on the lock screen, or you can hide notifications while presenting, which I probably should have turned on when I started this presentation, and I didn't. So occasionally you may see something pop up when I get an email. Would you rather not get an alert every single time you get an email message? Well, generally I do like it. See, and I just got a message from the from my anti-malware program, and it just said it was updated. So would you rather not get those kind of messages? You'll be happy to know that you can switch off notifications on a per-app basis. So while the settings, system, and notifications, you can go to each one and then turn them off. To silence all notifications from a particular app, toggle the switch on that app to the off position. If you would like to receive some kind of notification from an app, for example, you're okay with notification banners but would rather not have an alert sound play, you click the name of the app in question. Next, toggle the settings on the resulting screen as you please. So you can, for mail, for instance, you get notifications, show notification banners. You can keep them private on the lock screen. You can show in the Action Center, and you can even play a sound. So after a while, you might accumulate quite the collection of notifications in your Action Center. Clearing them out is easy enough. You just by click the icon in the system tray, it resembles the speech bubble, which I showed you. And to delete individual notifications, mouse over the notification you want to get rid of and click the X. Finally, if you want to delete all the notifications, you saw that I hit the clear all in the upper right, and they go away. So that's it for chapter 4, what I was going to show you. Let's go back up to the top. Again, you can peruse this on your own, but I'm going to jump to chapter 8 on the email and communications. And I'm just going to look at the first section there. Come on. And what I'm going to talk about is configuring Gmail, Yahoo, IMAP, or POP accounts in Outlook. Now, there's Outlook the program, there's Outlook.com, and then there's also, excuse me, the email. The email that comes with Windows 10. And all of this fits into your settings for any of those. So officially, only Outlook 2007, 10, 13, and 16, of course, are supposed to run on Windows 10. This also includes their respective versions. However, before starting Outlook on Windows 10, make sure you first apply at least Service Pack 3 for Office 2007, Service Pack 2 for Office 2010, or Service Pack 1 for Office 2013, and any additional updates. This takes care of some of the known compatibility issues. Continuing to use 2003 or earlier isn't really recommended on Windows on any version of Windows 10, that is, or on any version of Windows, actually. As 2003 has been out of extended support for some time now, and previous versions, of course, even longer. If you do use it, you'll encounter similar compatibility issues that existed when using it on Windows 8. When you're upgrading from Windows XP or Vista, you're actually doing a clean install of Windows 10 as the installation of Windows 10. And it'll only offer you the option to keep personal files only or nothing. Okay, when you select the keep the personal files only before upgrading, make sure you back up all your Outlook data, as upgrades can go wrong. And make sure you take good notes of the settings of your configured emails accounts, as you'll have to reconfigure them after installing Windows 10. When you're upgrading from Windows 7 or 8.1, then you can do an actual in-place upgrade as long as you are upgrading to the same Windows edition. In other words, if you have Home, you need to upgrade to the Home version. If you have the Professional, then you have to upgrade to the upgrade or the Professional. If you do the wrong version, it's going to want the key, and your key will not work. If you're using any add-ins with Outlook, make sure they're also compatible with Windows 10. And now you can add Gmail account to Outlook.com, and this is how, and it goes into how to do it. You want to remove the labels and using the import tool. Let me check the chat box. I see it's something. Okay, still. Okay, I'm hoping everybody else.
Yui? Yui, can you hear me?
Oh, I muted. There we go. I'm sorry about that.
That's okay. Now we hear you too.
Okay, now I'm not sure where I was, but I'll go back over the mail. I opened up the mail. I have just three accounts here, and I have those if they have mail, but I use Outlook as opposed to the Windows Mail, and so I don't normally use that, but I have it set up so if I want to do a quick email, I don't have to open up Outlook. I can do it from the Windows let's see, from the Windows mail program that's built in. Are there any questions from the audience at this point before I start going to a couple of the other comments, things that I have linked here? Arvin?
Anybody? Doesn't look like there are any questions.
Okay. All right. Now, I found another website, and this has questions and answers about software and Windows, and let me go to this site. This is called softwareok.com. Now, I didn't go to the home page because I believe it's overseas somewheres, and it's the English isn't the greatest, but there's a lot of really good information. There's also a really good fact page on Windows 7, Windows 8, and then down here on Windows 10. Let's just quickly go into the Windows 7, and let me make that larger. So you can Windows 7 Ultimate, X64 and 86, X86. Can I use my Windows XP wallpaper in Windows 7? Download Outlook or Mail in Windows 7. I'm just quickly looking at some of the titles. How do I know if I need to install 30-bit or 32-bit or 64-bit in 7? Of course, these are all on how to install, which if you're using Windows 7, it's installed. And you, if you're installing something new, I wouldn't recommend 7 at this point. But how to use the password reset disk in Windows 7, how to show the recycle bin icon in Windows 7 desktop, see if I can find, how to save and open searches in Windows 7. Let's just open one of these. You can see that they are very complete tutorials on how, when I say complete, there's some screenshots and some explanation on how to use these. So Windows 7, there's 65 different FAQs. And let's go back and go back one more. And let's look at Windows 10. And the article that I talked about earlier was number 43, was the shutdown and restart article, which was this article. That's the one where I demonstrated the creating of the icon, and then where is Paint Windows 10, how to open it, how to find installed programs and program files in Windows 10 to uninstall them. Let's just click that, and so you can see in his explanation, he does some screen captures with some pointing of where things are, and then an explanation of how to do it. Very well done. And should be easy enough for most of you to follow, even those who aren't experts at using Windows or using a computer. Stop your laptop from going to sleep when closed. And it tells you where the settings are, what to do, and how to do it. So I found that to be a pretty good website. And so that's the questions and answers about software and Windows located in the Windows SIG page for today's Windows SIG meeting. Now, 12 irritating Windows 10 installation issues and how to fix them. So if you're installing Windows 10, and I know several of you have not done that yet, excuse me, you may come across some of these things, and Woody Leonhard, who's a noted Windows writer, has done quite an extensive program of explaining and there's three pages of them of some things that can go wrong and then how to fix them. The next article on here is seven easy tips to extend your PC's lifespan. That's any PC. This isn't limited to the operating system, it is the PC itself. But keep it sport. Oh, let's see, we got a video playing here. That's what the noise is. Let me turn that off. The one thing I don't like about PC World, when you go to a page on them, a lot of times it starts a video automatically. If you open up two or three at first and then start going to them, you got two or three videos running at the same time. Anyway, keep it sparkling. In other words, open up your PC every once in a while with one of the dusters and clean it off. Shut it down first before you do this. And then give it time to dry out if because sometimes there is some if from the compressed air you sometimes get a little bit of moisture. So you want to make sure that that's not in there when you turn it back on. So you dust it, clean your fans, clean the intake and outtake fan places on the outside of your case as well as on the inside on the fans and on the fan blades. Do make sure that, especially if you have a dog or a cat, that you do this often. Give your PC room to breathe because there are air intakes and air outtakes. And so the air can circulate through your computer to keep it cool. The fans do some of that, but they're moving that air so it goes in and goes out. And so make sure that you don't put your computer into a closed area. If it's a laptop, don't put it on top of your bed. Put it on top of something on top of your bed so the air vents aren't covered. Also, you can stop your some hard drive issues before they blow up, and it tells you some things that you can do there. And don't forget to back up. They do say keep your hard drive defragmented. That's pretty much gone away. The new SSD drives don't require defragmenting, and the newer drives they don't recommend defragmenting. So I don't usually recommend it either. Protect against power surges. Have some kind of a surge protector. If you've got a UPS, that's even better, but make sure it has surge protection as well. Most of them do. A UPS is an uninterruptible power source, so if you get spikes or if you get power outages and they're just instant, where it just goes off and comes back on, a UPS, it'll automatically switch to the battery and then come back. If you have a laptop, it's not as necessary to have a UPS because with a laptop, it switches to its own battery and then switches back when the power comes back on. And it says protect against power loss too. Fend off malware. In other words, make sure that you have good software to watch for viruses and malware, but also use something like Malwarebytes in order to check for malware because most of the programs do not find the newest and latest immediately, so you can be infected even if you're protected. We've gone through websites like this before, but here's another one, Six Essential. Let's see, they're going to have a video start on us. Yep, let's make sure it's okay, it's off. They mentioned some programs that you should have. An antivirus, a supplemental malware scanner like Malwarebytes, some kind of a backup program. You want to have a password manager to keep track of your passwords. I've been helping several people with their computers, and they have either a box with cards in it with their passwords or a notepad or some type of a pad. They've written them all down, and it's usually kept somewhere near their computer. So if someone breaks in, steals their computer, the book is right there, and they probably can grab it as well, or they might just grab it. It's best if you use a password manager that's locked with a long password that only you know that only you use for that password manager, and you can keep track of all your passwords that way. I use one called eWallet from Illumisoft. There are several others that are very good. And I have over 900 passwords in that program. But I maintain it out on the cloud, but it does use 256K encryption, so it's well encrypted. I also have that same program on my iPad, my iPhone, and my two desktops, and my Surface with a very long password that I only use for that password manager. Then you should have some kind of a PDF reader. There are several of them out there that are free. Obviously, Adobe Acrobat Reader is free, but there are others that some people prefer. But I recommend that you have one. Most computers do come with some kind of a reader on them, but do update them because there are issues, and some people can embed information in a PDF if it's vulnerable. If your reader hasn't been updated, you might get infected that way as well. So those are six essential types of programs that you should have on your computer. We're getting close to time, so let's see what else. I do have an article on 15 things you didn't know you could do with Dropbox. I'm not going to go through any of these, but for those of you using Dropbox, this is a very good article where you can get file requests from anyone. You can preview Photoshop and Illustrator files directly from Dropbox. You can rejoin shared folders, find files faster with Dropbox, recents, and so on. So if you use Dropbox or are considering it, you might want to take a look at that article. And then there's one called How to Tell If Your Computer is Vulnerable to Hackers and How to Use Your Google Calendar in the Windows 10 Calendar app. I'm going to jump to that first. This is a very good article from How to Geek, and it goes through and does talk about and give you some screen captures of what you should set and how to set it. And just before I end, I'm going to minimize this. I'm going to bring up my calendar. And you can see all of these things that are on my calendar are in my Google Calendar. I maintain this all in Google Calendar. So all of the things, so when I update them and so on, I do it in Google Calendar, and I'm able to do it and then see it within the Google program. Let's see, where was I here? Let's see, how to use your Google Calendar. There we go. I'm able to either go online to google.com, sign in with my account, and view the Google Calendar itself and update it. So I can view that calendar from anywhere, but I can also do it directly from the calendar. Program from consider that. Google Calendar is great. I maintain a couple of websites, and for those organizations, I have their calendars in Google Calendar, and all I have to do is get the embed codes, and I can embed them directly into a page on their website, and their calendar is there. The final article that I've got listed on here is how to tell if your computer is vulnerable to hackers. And so there's some ways in which you can test your own system. So you might want to read the article. One of them uses Gibson's research shields up. Steve Gibson is a longtime expert in computer security, and he's written a program's been used to test hard drives for years, and so it's very he's very well known And his Shields Up website is very good, and it does show how open or how well protected your computer is. But it also, there's some other information where you can, as you read through this article, will tell you some helpful information to make sure that you're protected and how well your computer is protecting you. So see how well your antivirus is working. There's a way to do that. So these are some, how secure is your computer? And so that's a great article to have in your repertoire. And there's the link for it, the second one from the bottom. So those are my meeting notes for today. I've got a few minutes to answer some questions before you get to hear Abby Stokes and talk about technology. So at this session, let's see, I've got to come down here and stop sharing and come back to the logo, and then I'll answer any questions.
The microphone's live now. Anybody has a question?
Yes, it is.
Question? Anybody question?
Have you ever heard of
UBT?
Yeah.
Have you ever heard of
UBT? Something like you got to press the one with doing a password or something like that.
UBT, I'm not familiar with that phrase or those letters, and I'm not hearing what they're saying about it.
Okay. I have a question, Huey.
Okay.
I just put my laptop back online. It's got Windows 10 on it, and it had that problem where sometimes when you boot, you can't get to the start menu and all that kind of thing. Have they solved that yet?
Now, is it, which computer is it? Is it a Surface?
No, it's a Lenovo Yoga laptop. It's about 3 years old.
But I know Surface. Surface was having an issue, and it was a hardware driver issue, and they've done a couple of firmware updates, and I'm not having as much of an issue with that. I think what you're normally finding when you have that, sometimes, I shouldn't say normally, but sometimes it may be because your computer went to sleep and woke up, but sometimes you just have to reboot it, and as far as I know, there has not been a fix for it.
All right. Very good.
Because I'm not sure what the issue is.
Windows 10, when I turn it on, my desktop comes up with my icons in one place. The next time it'll come up with them all spread out, and I can't find the ones I'm looking for. Does anybody know what the problem is with the setup or whatever? It won't, I can set them in a place I want them, but it won't keep them there.
Did you hear that, Yui?
Something to the effect that when he shuts down and then starts up again, the icons aren't in the same place.
Correct.
Ever.
It changes every time.
Are you using Task View by any chance?
No.
I've not heard of that at all. The only thing I could suggest is do a Google search and see if other people are. And use the phrase something similar to saving icon location on desktop, Windows 10, something like that.
Microsoft.
And as you find a few articles, then find some keywords in them to redo your search.
Microsoft Store says, bring the computer to me, we'll fix it. So I've got to do that.
I didn't hear what he said.
He said the Microsoft Store told him to bring the computer to them and they would fix it.
By the way, that, and I think I've mentioned that at some other meetings, the Microsoft Store has a policy of making sure that whatever is broken, they help you fix it. They may have to wipe your computer to do it, but they will find a way to help you fix it. Use them. They don't charge for that. So you have to make an appointment generally. Because they do, you might be lucky and get in there and just wait 10 or 15 minutes, but you might want to call ahead, see if they have somebody, because they only have two or three people that help you. They're on the floor, and they'll sit down with you and try to figure out what your issue is. If you have a laptop, it makes it, of course, a lot easier, or a tablet. But if you have a desktop, they will work with you with that as well. So utilize that free service, because they will try to help you and help fix it.
Okay. Joey, can you hear me?
Barely. Somebody will probably have to repeat the question, but go ahead.
I have encountered a couple of Dell laptops that people have that they have on Windows 7. When I've looked into upgrading them to Windows 10, you go to the Dell website, they comment on that particular model that it is not supported for an upgrade to Windows 10. Do you recommend trying it anyway, or would you just stay away?
Did you hear any of that, Huey?
No, I did not.
Okay.
Something about Dell's all I got.
Yeah, Dick has acquired several Dell laptops, and they're in Windows 7. He was interested in upgrading to Windows 10, but when he went to Dell's website, those particular models were specifically mentioned that they do not recommend it. Update, it is not supported by Dell.
Well, that tells you something. Probably why you have them.
Yeah, I would have Dell. Do you know the model?
Yeah, if you might want to look at the amount of memory you have, how big the hard drive is, but they're probably the drivers for some of their,
yeah,
like their screen,
gotta be,
or
got to be driver.
There might be a driver issue. If there are several that are the same model, and you have the original you had the original hard drive in it that has, you can go back to factory fresh, go ahead and do the update, see what happens. If it doesn't work, you can either go back to 7 or just tell it to do a clean install from your from the Dell itself, from the Dell recovery portion of the hard drive.
Does anyone have the problem where you do a shutdown
I have had that problem twice, that's all.
Would you repeat the question, please?
Has anyone had the problem of when you do a shutdown, it shuts down but then restarts all by itself? I've had that problem just once or twice. I had it yesterday, as a matter of fact.
Sometimes that will happen if it's doing an update. It will complete the update, and then you have to shut it down again.
Right. There you go. Makes sense.
Okay, is Abby there yet?
Abby is here.
Abby, hi, how are you? I'm sorry I'm not there.
Stan,
and I'm sure you're going to,
Stan,
I'm sure you're going to give, okay.
Now for those of us who do want to go to Windows 10, what is the cutoff of the free upgrade?
July
27th. July 27th.
Well, according to Microsoft, it's July of this year. However, there's a lot of talk is they'll probably extend that date, but I would probably recommend that if you're going to do it before that date, because you don't know. They may charge some kind of a fee after that.
All right, thank you.
Okay, on that note, I'm going to end the Windows SIG, and I'm glad you all attended. We had a couple of people online, and I hopefully got a good recording, so you'll be able to share it with friends. And on that note, I will say adieu.
I do.
Thanks, Huey.
I do too.
Has everybody signed the attendance?